Thank you. That was great. Sounded great. And, you know, we always get not only the bells, but we get a juggling act as well if you watch Doug. Oh, did she? I couldn't see Anna's hands over here. But, yeah, that's that is kind of funny to watch. Doug needs like two more hands usually. Good morning to everyone. Good to see everyone here this morning. It's a nice day. The sun might not be out yet, but it's not raining and it's none of that snowy stuff. Not gonna say it too loud. Doug, we have some birthdays this week that we're going to sing to. Both on Friday this week. One of them is our own Tom's wife, Amber. So Amber and Jamin Skelton also this week. So let's sing to them too today. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Amber and Jamin. Happy birthday to you. Birthdays are always good. And if you would, please rise for our call to worship. Our call to worship this week is taken from Psalm 18, verses 1 through 3. I love you, Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. And our response: my God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise. Amen. If you would please remain standing for our praise music. Please be seated. Again, I want to thank you here this morning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You can see our readings are up on the board for this morning. And if you would, please give a wave hello to the folks who are watching and listening at home. It's good to have you with us today. Also, remember, this next Saturday from 9 to noon is the cleanup here at the church. In and out, it will be regardless of the weather, because if it's so bad outside, you can definitely have things to do inside. So there's shouldn't be any problem with that. So we've had a lot of really good attendance for all of the different educational events that we've been having. Third season of The Chosen is playing Tuesdays at Jill's, and first season of The Chosen is playing here at the church. I feel like we're a movie house. And we're also doing Bible study afterwards as well on Wednesdays. So it's been really great. If you haven't been coming, well, you've been missing out. But you could come anytime and join right in. And also, our October mission has been going very well, from my understanding. And it's a great mission for peace and global witness through the Presbytery. It's one of the four for the year. And I told you before, there is a envelope in your giving box that pertains to this. So, and if you don't have a giving box, well, you can let us know and we can get you one, but also you can use the envelopes that are in your pews. So, but just mark on there that this is for peace and global witness, or even if you just put October mission, that would be fantastic. Thank you again. Now let's bow our heads together for our prayer of confession. Father, we are gathered before you, the maker of heaven and earth, whose chosen dwelling place is with the broken and contrite, to confess that we have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with all of our heart and soul. We have not loved you with all of our mind and strength. We have not even loved our neighbor as ourselves. Purge us from selfishness, the fear of man, and the love of praise. In your mercy, deepen our sorrow for the wrong we have done and for the good we have left undone, so that we may hate our sin with a holy hatred. But please, Father, do not leave us in sorrow. Now, if you would, please take this time for silent prayer. With you, O Lord, there is forgiveness. In your mercy, restore the joy of our salvation so that we may love you with a holy love. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And if you would please say with me today our assurance of pardon. God is slow to anger and full of compassion. He gives all who humbly repent and trust in his Son as Savior and Lord. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. If you would please rise for hymn number 214, He Has Made Me Glad. Luke 6, verse 38 tells us the words of Jesus. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For the measure that you use, it will be measured to you. While we enjoy this next piece of music, let us consider how we may offer our time, our talents, or any other good gifts that we have received from the Lord to benefit and further God's will for his creation. Your tithes and offerings may be placed in the plate at the back of the sanctuary as you're leaving today. Please rise. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give with joy into your kingdom today. May you bless our offering. Come, O Lord, and work through these gifts. Extend your love through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. And let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
This morning's Old Testament reading comes from Psalms 90, 10 through 17, which may be found on page 929 of your Pew Bible. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures, yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. If only we knew the power of your anger, your wrath is as great as the fear that is your due. Teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, Lord, how long will it be? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all of our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, for as many years as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to their children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us, establish the works of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. May God bless this reading of his holy word.
A reading from Acts chapter 9, 1 through 6, which may be found on page 1706 of your Pew Bible. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The fact that everyone is different, in my opinion, is one of the ways that makes the world go round. There are all kinds of people out there, kind, shy, nasty, bold, pushy, affable, tolerant, giving, fearful, tough, hateful. That list could go on for a long time. These qualities that we find in each person, and many times multiple qualities at the same time, influence how we interact with each other and how we affect this world. So, for example, each U.S. president brings with them a personality that is generally different in some ways than the previous one. This can seem good or bad, depending on which side of the fence you're standing. Rulers seem to have that effect on people. They will either love them or hate them, depending on whether they agree with their sensibilities or not. Every 4 years, our country goes through the same mudslinging rituals that they call presidential elections. And every 4 years, we try to drive more wedges between ourselves and others, particularly those who we think differently or who think differently than us. Now, I'm not speaking here of anyone in any particular political party, but all of them, because they're all guilty of the same reprehensible behavior. My point is this: we continually concern ourselves with how our differences divide us instead of recognizing that these same differences can make us stronger. This brings me to the heart of the matter, God's will. What about God's will? We are usually so consumed with our own will that we forget to even think about the plain and simple fact that it is God's will that will rule the day, not ours. And that we would be amazed if we really realize just how much the Almighty uses even our negatives to achieve his positives. We're all a result of a lifetime of living. We are all affected by different things that have happened in our own lives. Some are tragic. Some are wonderful. Some are humbling. Some are fear-inducing. Each time we are affected by one of these things, it causes in us a reactionary response. For example, a tragedy may have happened in your life that causes you to help others with similar issues. Or maybe you have been an addict, and through your recovery, have dedicated yourself to guiding others in the same predicament. These are good things. But there can also be bad things. Some are molested when they're growing up and never get help. Maybe they too were embarrassed and didn't want anyone to know, so they built a psychological wall around their hearts and never allowed anyone to be able to get close to them again, robbing them of the ability to love others or to be loved in the manner in which God intended. Still bringing us to the same point, God uses even our negatives to achieve his positives. Listen to this story about King David from 1 Chronicles 28, verses 1 through 13 and 19 through 21. David summoned all the officials of Israel to assemble at Jerusalem. The officers over the tribes, the commanders of the divisions in the service of the king, the commanders of thousands and the commanders of hundreds, and the officials in charge of all the property and livestock belonging to the king and his sons, together with the palace officials, the warriors, and all the brave fighting men. King David rose to his feet and said, "Listen to me, my fellow Israelites, my people. I had it in my heart to build a house as a place of rest for the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, for the footstool of our God, and I made plans to build it. But God said to me, 'You are not to build a house for my name, because you are a warrior and have shed blood.' Yet the Lord, the God of Israel, chose me from my whole family to be king over Israel forever. He chose Judah as leader, and from the tribe of Judah, he chose my family. And from my father's sons, he was pleased to make me king over all Israel. All of my sons, and the Lord has given me many, he has chosen my son Solomon to sit on the throne of the kingdom of the Lord over Israel. He said to me, 'Solomon, your son, is the one who will build my house and my courts. For I have chosen him to be my son, and I will be his father. I will establish his kingdom forever if he is unswerving in carrying out my commands and laws, as is being done at this time. So now I charge you in the sight of all Israel and of the assembly of the Lord and in the hearing of our God, be careful to follow all the commands of the Lord our God, that you may possess this land and pass it on as an inheritance to your descendants forever. And you, my son Solomon, acknowledge the God of your father and serve him with wholehearted devotion and with a willing mind, for the Lord searches every heart and understands every desire and every thought. If you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will reject you forever. Consider now, for the Lord has chosen you to build a house as the sanctuary. Be strong and do the work." Then David gave his son Solomon the plans for the portico of the temple, its buildings, its storerooms, its upper parts, its inner rooms, and the place of atonement. He gave him the plans of all that the Spirit had put in his mind for the courts of the temple of the Lord and all the surrounding rooms, for the treasuries of the temple of God and for the treasuries for the dedicated things. He gave him instructions for the divisions of the priests and the Levites and for all the work of serving in the temple of the Lord, as well as for all the articles to be used in its service. Scripture tells us that God loved King David. But God had a specific function for David, to be the king of Israel. God used the qualities of David, his bold spirit, his great faith, his fearless nature, his ability to lead, and his ability to respect and love God's guidance to make him be a powerful king. All great qualities for the type of king God needed David to be. But this was not the same qualities that he wanted for the one to build his temple. God does not want a warrior for this. So he chose Solomon for the monumental task. The same goes for Moses. God chose Moses because he was uniquely equipped to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. Moses was born an Israelite, a Hebrew, but raised in Pharaoh's house by Pharaoh's own daughter, giving Moses insight into the inner workings of the ruling class and the military of Egypt. I could go on about other things that prepared Moses for the Exodus, but it's enough to know that God prepares us for what he needs us to do. When Moses reached the promised land, God allowed him to see it, but it was not his task to enter into it. For that task, God prepared Joshua. As you can see, God knows what he's doing. And he uses all of our qualities, both good and bad, to achieve his perfect will. Once there was a man named Saul. Not King Saul, but Saul of Tarsus, a city in modern-day Turkey. Tarsus was a city within the Roman Empire, making Saul a Roman citizen. He was a Jew, though, of the tribe of Benjamin, and he was a Pharisee. The Pharisees were a social movement around the time of the Second Temple in and around Jerusalem. The Pharisees saw themselves as set apart from the rest, especially Gentiles or non-religious Jews. They placed an emphasis on the law of the Torah and above all else, and their bloodlines being connected to Abraham and God's covenant with him and his ancestors. This elitism and their worship of the law was usually what got the Pharisees into trouble with Jesus, as they had focused so much on the law itself that they forgot about mercy, love, and forgiveness. Saul happened to be a very zealous Pharisee who was regularly hunting down these new Christians and putting them to death for blasphemy. Our New Testament lesson today describes how on the road to Damascus to root out more Christians, Saul has an encounter with the risen Christ in all his glory and hears his voice asking him why he is persecuting him and telling him to go and wait for word as to what to do next. We pick up the rest of the story from Acts 9, verses 7 through 31. The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but they did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. All those who heard him were astonished and asked, "Isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on this name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests?" Yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Messiah. After many days had gone by, there was a conspiracy among the Jews to kill him. But Saul learned of their plan Day and night, they kept close watch on the city gates in order to kill him. But his followers took him by night and lowered him in a basket through an opening in the wall. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he was really a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. He talked and debated with the Hellenistic Jews, but they tried to kill him. When the believers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Then the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace and was strengthened. Living in the fear of the Lord and encouraged by the Holy Spirit, it increased in numbers. God uniquely prepared Saul to become Paul. Paul being the apostle to the Gentiles, us. God used Saul's Roman citizenship and his Jewish heritage to bridge both worlds and to spread his message better. Saul's zealous devotion was also used, but tempered with the Holy Spirit so as not to become overzealous. Becoming Paul, he became exactly what God needed to increase the number of believers in the Greek and Jewish worlds, as well as begin the foundation for the conversion of Rome itself, and ultimately the whole future Western world, us. I think he did a pretty good job. I have told you that you are not exempt from God's plan, and that we each have been given qualities and gifts that are to be used for God's will. How has life molded you? In what ways have you been affected, good and bad? Which quality are you currently using? And are you using it for your will or for God's will? Or maybe both. If you were traveling and encountered the risen Christ as Paul did, what would he say to you? How has God uniquely prepared you for service? You think you're not qualified, and that God wouldn't choose you? Think again. Moses and Jonah thought the same way, and they couldn't escape it any more than you can. I was asked many times if I wanted to become a pastor, to which I said I didn't feel like that was my path, but God had a different plan. We are not all destined to become a pastor, but that doesn't mean that God doesn't have a plan for all of us. My advice to all of you is that when God calls your name, don't run and hide. Don't think that you're not qualified. Listen intently for what he is telling you, and know that he prepares us all for his work. God doesn't make mistakes. If he chooses you for service, then be ready and willing to do what is required of you for the most important and most rewarding service you will ever perform. All glory be to God, now and forever. Amen. If you would please rise for hymn number 327, The Old Rugged Cross. Be seated.
The Deacon's Prayer for the People. Let us pray. God our Father, who creates all that is and all that will be, we thank you for always being with us and caring for our needs and well-being. You promise where two or more gather in your name, you are with us and hear us. Now, Lord, hear our prayer for those close to us. We pray for Neil Dirchman, Baby Kai, Felicia Archer, Monica March Ross, Connie Carey, Patty Kuna, the Matlack family, Sarah Cornelius, Phyllis Sturdivant, Emily Tuttle, Al Alster, Greg Kars, Florence Brower, Sharon Gallagher, Craig Kinney, Lois Garfield, Paul Jensen, Aggie Roach, Joyce Shannon McLeod, John Tecker, Mary Thompson, Carl Walpusk, the Wells family, John Banks, Scott Bain, Andrew Fisher, Joe Manuela, Fuzzy Pakella, Joe Cassano, Cassie Black, Reverend Rick Cypress, Nora and Jeffrey Tombaugh, David Lanigan, Paula Taig, Betty Markoff, Stan Lesneski, Stephanie Kriegish, all those affected by war in the Ukraine and in Israel, Adam and AJ Brine, Jake Robleski, Toby Charlton, Jonathan Skelton, and other members of our armed forces. Almighty God, may we be to others what they need, a body to work when others cannot, a heart to love those who are forgotten, a shoulder to console those whose soul is in need, a smile to brighten the most somber of your children, and a mouth to proclaim your love. Strengthen and guide our congregation to know your will and be of service to our community. Help us to be a beacon of light, gathering and leading your people to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
The opportunity to eat and drink with Christ is not a right bestowed upon the worthy, but a privilege given to the undeserving. All who come in faith, repentance, and love to the Lord's table are offered the bread and cup, regardless of their age, their understanding, their denominational faith, or whether they have been baptized or not. Remember that those of you watching online are welcome to partake in this communion with us. All you need is some juice or wine, bread and crackers, and to just follow along. Please stand for number 464, come to the table. Please be seated. Brothers and sisters, this is the Lord's table. People will come from all over the earth and sit together in the kingdom of God. Our Savior invites those who trust him to share in this feast, which he has prepared for the joyful people of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at the table with his disciples, he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them, and their eyes were opened and they recognized him. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Let's pray. Almighty Father, you spoke the world into being. Your word became flesh in Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, you made us your people. When we were lost in sin, you found us, sending us your prophets and even your own Son. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the choirs of angels and with all the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name. Now, let us pray for God's rule on earth as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Holy Father, we give you thanks that on the night of his arrest, Jesus took the bread. And after giving thanks to you, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup in the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The body of Christ given to you, take and eat. The blood of Christ shed for you, take and drink. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, you have filled us with your life. Christ, our Savior, you have embraced us in your love. God, our Father, you have fed us with your grace. Now send us into your beloved world to share your life, your love, and your grace with all. Blessing and honor and glory to you, holy, holy, holy Lord. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great. Your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name.
Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the
pure.
isn't it great that we have a God who has everything in hand, but he allows us, our creative natures that he has given to us, and the abilities and gifts that he has given to us, to partner with him. That's amazing when you really think about it, that we are in partnership with God Almighty to help bring as many people to him as possible. That's amazing. And it's also amazing that you are all, every single one of you, a part of that plan. It may be just the people that you meet in the course of a day, or the people that you work with, or the any people that you encounter. Maybe you're in line at the store, or maybe you're eating at a restaurant and someone witnesses you praying before you eat, or they witness how you seem to have an air about you of goodness that God has given you. That's being a great witness to God, just in itself. That can be a major part of God's plan for you. It may not be that you're a pastor, or that you sing in the choir, or that you play the bells, but maybe it's just that you are a witness to him, to everyone you meet, and that you're one heck of a prayer. So remember, we are all part of this plan. So today I charge you to go out into the world asking yourself, why am I here? In this particular church, in this particular town, in this particular community, at this particular time in my life, how has God prepared you for service? How will he use all your unique qualities to further his perfect will? And the most important question, will you be prepared to say, your will be done? Now receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace today, this week, and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.